Morning again, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for re-entering the hall for this sixth plenary session. You can see we have a tremendous lineup. A great deal of stimulating thoughts are about to be shared with you as soon as you settle down and take your seats. But we're delighted to have, and I'll call them in short order in the as they are listed on our program, Nikolaos Dendias, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Greece, who was with us here last year. He'll speak first. I should again note that the IISS is working on a major strategic dossier on the geopolitics and geoeconomics of the Eastern Mediterranean, where around nine countries have all sorts of conflicting and competing and in some cases cooperative arrangements for their to preserve and advance their geostrategic and geoeconomic interests in the area. And I think the Eastern Mediterranean is becoming a sort of sub-strategic region of its own accord. Again, for the second year running, we're delighted to have Dr. Eyal Hulata, National Security Advisor of Israel. You recall he was here last year to, as it were, mark diplomatically the reality of the Abraham Accords and how they are facilitating, as the title of this plenary suggests, new and relevant security partnerships in the Middle East. And again, for the second year running, we're delighted to have Brett McGurk. All of you know him well, since he's so frequently present in this region, the coordinator for the Middle East and North Africa at the National Security Council in the United States. So with that, and taking pleasure in the fact that you've all, almost with perfect timing, now settled, could I invite Nikolaos Dendias, Foreign Minister of Greece, to make his remarks from the podium? Yeah, no, you've got to get up there, because otherwise we won't have a good photograph of you speaking here.
Well, John, first of all, thank you. And I have to say it's very encouraging that you're trying to do a dossier for the Eastern Mediterranean. Good luck with that. I'm trying to figure it out for the last 3.5 years. Well, having said that, I'm going to try to find optimistic notes around the region. And keep it short, so we would have time for dialogue, and I would be very much willing and happy to answer questions. Well, generally, you know, it is, you know, I was thinking this morning what we were thinking of the world after the fall of the Berlin Wall, the idea that history has ended and the world is getting to a great normality and we'll all live happily ever after. And now we are in a world infested with conflicts, and we have seen war returning even to Europe in the 21st century, from white to black. And of course, the Eastern Mediterranean and the Gulf region and Africa and the Middle East, as historically, it is really the place where many conflicts coexist, many antagonisms coexist. But can we find something positive on this region? I would mention three things. I would start with the Abraham Accords, which I think is a game changer. We have here somebody that's much more capable of talking about that than me, but being an observer sometimes gives you a very clear picture. I think that the Abraham Accords have changed completely the narrative, not just of the Middle East, but on the overall region. Israel is able and willing to cooperate with Arab countries and create a new reality on the ground. The second thing, which is smaller, but I have to say, from my side of view, even a greater achievement is the delimitation agreement between Israel and Lebanon. Because on this agreement, we see something quite unique. An agreement between two countries that yet again they do not recognize each other. And yet again, they find ways not only to resolve a long-standing issue, but also apply international law and international law of the sea on the resolution of this issue, which means accepting that the world is a rules-based society, and at the same time, creating a great example for the Mediterranean and for the world on the contested issue of delimitation of sea zones. And if I'm allowed to mention a third great example, is the delimitation agreement between Greece and Egypt, something that was negotiated for something like 35 years. Because this delimitation, which I had the honor to sign with my dear friend Samek Sukri, is not just a bilateral agreement on delimitation of sea zones. It's a connecting lane between Africa and Europe, which you could be used for interconnectors, for pipelines, and at the same time, again, it's a perfect example of how application of international law and international law of the sea creates the perfect example of how could countries could resolve differences through dialogue, through application of international law, through acceptance of a rules-based order, and move forward and create stability and wealth and prosperity, not just for their own citizens, but for the citizens of a much larger area than that. I will stop here because I thought that the best thing I can do to raise your spirits is, in this very difficult time for the world, is at least underline three successes we had recently. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And I'm sure you'll be cross-examined shortly, both on those successes and the fourth and fifth ones that you will want to achieve in the next 6 months or a year. Dr. Eyal Hulata.
Thank you, John. Distinguished delegates and colleagues, dear friends, it is a pleasure to be here again and an honor to speak in front of you on behalf of the State of Israel. First, I would like to express my deepest appreciation for the gracious Bahraini hospitality. Thank you to His Majesty King Hamad bin Isa Al Khalifa and Crown Prince His Royal Highness Sheikh Salman for this outstanding event. Also, thanks to the IISS Manama Dialogue organizers, and especially to you, John, for your true friendship. Minister Dendias, I would like to thank you and your Prime Minister Matsitakis for your role in strengthening the Israeli-Greek partnership. You've demonstrated the value of having like-minded neighbors in our region, arena, as well as within the European Union numerous times over the years. And my close friend, Brett McGurk, on a personal note, I've enjoyed working with you in strengthening the strategic partnership between our countries and specifically in building security partnership in the Middle East. I want to thank you for all of that you have done, and through you, to thank President Biden for the ironclad strategic partnership with Israel. Last year, I stood on this stage and described regional threats and opportunities. My underlying message was that Israel's contribution to the region's stability and prosperity was becoming visible. A year later, I think that we can proudly reflect on several important achievements and conclude that the contribution of an integrated Israel resonates far beyond the Middle East borders. In the past year, we worked closely with our allies and partners to enhance regional stability through diplomatic, economic, and military means, while creating a hub for cooperation to jointly tackle energy, food security, technological, and climate-related challenges that benefit the citizens of the region, as well as the global community. More than anything, we work together to fend against Iran. Israel's most prominent security threat is clearly Iran. More broadly, Iran is the most dangerous challenge for most of the countries in the region. Building upon the message delivered by the President of the European Commission, Ms. Ursula von der Leyen, in her opening statement of this conference, in recent months, it is becoming more obvious than ever that Iran is a global, clear, and present danger. Here is a a brief list of events we all should be aware of just from this year. Alongside constant attacks against Israeli and American forces, Iran has increased its proxy activities to destabilize Yemen, Iraq, and Syria. Iran uses cyber attacks on a regular basis, but this year, they took the freedom to even attack civilian infrastructure in Albania, a NATO member. Iran has dramatically bolstered its kinetic attacks against civilian infrastructure in the UAE and Saudi Arabia. We all remember the cruise and ballistic missiles rounds on January 17th, 24th, 31st, and February 1st in the UAE. That should have been unheard of. In recent weeks, Iranian drones are killing civilian Ukrainians. If Iran is not stopped, it is likely that they will deploy accurate and short-range missile ballistic missiles as well. They also continue their habit to crash drones on civilian vessels on international waters. An oil tanker named Pacific Zircon was attacked not far from the shore of Oman just a few days ago. This is in addition to Iran's terrorist attacks throughout the world against Israelis, Europeans, Americans, and opposition Iranian dissents in Turkey, Cyprus, Colombia, Georgia, Germany, UK, and even the United States, just to name a few locations of terror attempts. This is all aimed at all of us. But this year, Iran has embarked on brutal crackdown against its own people. Israel has been saying that for years, and so many distinguished speakers have said clearly from this stage, each in their own words, enough. Enough with futile talks in Vienna as they are advancing their nuclear program. Enough with ignoring Iranian deception and manipulation of the IAEA inspectors. Enough with keeping a blind eye as they smuggle arms on a regular basis to feed regional terror. And enough with hoping, in vain, that a corrupt and dangerous regime will play nice. Even the people of Iran are saying enough. How can the international community look away as the people of Iran are targeted, abused, arrested, and killed for their pursuit of freedom in their own homeland? I know that anything we Israelis say about the protests will be politically labeled. We're always accused in anything bad that's happening in Iran. But this is not about us. This is about freedom. Personally, as a son of a Persian descent mother, I extend a direct message to the brave people of Iran. Zan Zendegi Azadi. In English it is women, life, freedom. And in Hebrew, Isha Chaim Chofesh. In the past year, Israel has worked closely with the American administration to ensure that Iran does not acquire nuclear weapons, a joint goal we all share. President Biden has shown his resolve and commitment that Iran will never acquire nuclear weapons and that the U.S. will adhere to its commitment towards its interests and partners in the region. We deepened our policy, operational, and intelligence cooperation with the U.S., the E3, and our partners in the region to better cope with Iranian aggression and to intensify the pressure on the Iranian regime. Together, we will continue to form a regional architecture that could protect countries from the threat of rockets, missiles, and drones, preserve the freedom of maritime navigation, and thwart cyber and terrorist attacks. This is in the best interest of all countries represented in this room today. I want to move to talk on regional integration and seizing opportunities. In the past year, we took Israel's integration into the region to new heights. Many new initiatives are materializing, bridging between countries and addressing core challenges with the power to reshape the regional landscape. We deepened our relations with the signatories, countries of the Abraham Accords. A free trade agreement with the UAE was signed, and we have similar draft to be signed soon with Bahrain. Security arrangements were concluded with multiple countries. Trade and tourism are enhanced with Morocco and much more. The Negev Summit has gathered in Israel the foreign ministers of the countries in the region together with the American Secretary of State to deliver a message of friendship and partnership. The ITU2 Forum, putting together Israel, India, the US, and the UAE, has convened both on foreign ministers and heads of state levels to promote economic projects, particularly in food security and clean energy. We strengthened our relations with Jordan and with Egypt. The leaders of our countries met multiple times during the last year and fortified the joint commitment to collaboration and peace. Last year, I flew from here directly to Dubai to sign a declaration of intent with Jordan to build Prosperity Green, a 600 megawatt capacity solar plant with storage to be built in Jordan for Israeli use, and Prosperity Blue, the export to Jordan of 200 million cubic meters of desalinated water per year from Israel. Last week, during COP27 at Sharm el-Sheikh, another milestone was reached and signed in the Prosperity projects, and we are all working hard to implement them as fast as possible. We also expanded our attempts to increase regional integration beyond the Abraham Accords, drawing on American leadership. An agreement was reached with the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to allow the development in the Red Sea while maintaining proper security arrangements. Saudi Arabia approved for the first time that Israeli airlines can fly freely over the kingdom. There are still hurdles. Nothing is easy in the Middle East, but we have made progress that I believe and hope will materialize in the near future and open the way for more regional integration. And finally, we recently signed a groundbreaking agreement with Lebanon to end a long maritime dispute. I want to thank President Biden and the facilitator Amos Hochstein for brokering this deal. A lot was said about this agreement, both in Lebanon and in Israel. But here are the plain and simple facts, as my friend also talked about it just a few minutes ago. Two countries with a long history of war have reached an agreement for the economic benefits of both peoples. Israel has secured its claimed maritime territorial border, while the development of present and future prospects could now be carried out without threats. Israel hopes that this agreement will benefit the Lebanese people, assist in the economic recovery of their country, and reduce the damaging grip of Iran. This agreement will also have a stabilizing effect in the entire Eastern Mediterranean zone and in continuity to the Eastern Mediterranean Gas Forum achievements and the Egypt-EU-Israeli LNG agreement signed in Cairo in June. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, our work has yielded remarkable success in the past year. This is only the beginning, and the sky is the limit. The achievements we've reached this year have improved Israel's security while spreading good in the near region and the wider global arena. This is our neighborhood. I'm confident that Israel's integration in the region is vital for a better future for all of us and for global stability. My hope is that this process will continue and that in future years we will all see progress and prosperity that will make us all proud. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eyal, for that very strong statement and for the variety of agreements and initiatives that you were describing in it. Now, could I invite Brett McGurk, Coordinator for the Middle East and North Africa, the National Security Council in the United States.
Thank you, John. I want to thank again His Highness King Hamad, Crown Prince Salman, the hospitality of the Bahraini people, and IISS for this extraordinary forum. It's great to be back again. I have to mention Eyal Hulata, who we were on the stage here last year at this time. You wear a suit and tie, but you're a warrior for the interests of your country. And we have really worked incredibly closely together over the course of the last year, and we're fortunate that so many U.S. interests overlap with yours. So we have got a lot done and have a lot to do, as you just laid out. The title of this panel is New Security Partnerships, and I'd like to, over the next 10 minutes, step back a little bit and build on what you heard from Dr. Colin Call and General Carrilla and others over the course of this weekend. And one thing, every year we're here as Americans, whether from one administration to the next, as private citizens or U.S. officials, we hear questions here about U.S. commitments to this region. And every year, senior officials like myself or others, we make clear that we remain committed, that our interests with this region are too interwoven for the answer to be otherwise. It's truly an immutable fact. Yet each year, those statements and commitments are called into doubt by some. So while I appreciate that nothing myself or anyone else can say will fully alleviate this concern that exists about America's commitment to this vital region, I will state again up front, representing the White House, and for the reasons I'll discuss, it's truly a false construct. It was untrue now as it was last year and years ago. But I know it's one we must constantly address, and we're pleased and grateful for this forum that allows us to do so. However, there is one concern we hear that is real, and it has to do with the direction of the United States of America itself. Where are we headed as a country? How durable are our policies? It's something we hear behind closed doors, and of course we hear in public. As you hear President Biden often say in some of his earliest meetings with counterparts as president, the question he got was, America is back, but for how long? So before addressing specifically this region, I want to review the bidding a little bit on what the Biden administration and President Biden has done in 2 short years when it comes to the United States at home. Because we know the state of our own country, we recognize it drives much of the anxiety we hear in this region, and ultimately its most essential element to an effective and predictable foreign policy. That's why what's been done in the last 2 years in the United States at home might risk being overlooked when discussing international affairs, yet it is most important to what we're trying to do here in this region and elsewhere around the world. So just three things just to put on the table that you're all familiar with, but I just want to review it. The bipartisan infrastructure law that was passed last year, $150 billion investment in our own infrastructure, in roads, bridges, networks of electric vehicle chargers, airports, public transit, the largest investment we have made since the Eisenhower administration. Second, the CHIPS Act, historic investments in science and semiconductors, $280 billion in funding to boost domestic research and high-tech manufacturing and production across our country. Third, what's called the Inflation Reduction Act, but which is the largest ever investment in clean energy and domestic energy production in the United States. So these are three historic and transformational pieces of legislation that will define and position the United States for the future at home and abroad. The bottom line, as you heard from Dr. Call, it's never smart to bet against the United States, particularly now, as we are investing massively in our own country and our future. And President Biden put it this way last week at the G20, quote, no nation is now better positioned to help build the future we want than the United States of America. These investments at home often translate directly into foreign policy through, for example, the Partnership for Global Infrastructure and Investment, PGII, where we're working with partners, including here in the Gulf, to invest in the ports, airports, essential minerals, to ensure stable supply chains, all the key elements that will define and secure the future and our collective resilience. And moreover, while I don't want to make a political point on this stage, I think there's no question that our recent election once again demonstrated the resilience of American democracy, which we recognize had been called into some doubt, and a more stable democratic trajectory that can begin to reassure partners and more predictable policies, which at the end of the day are the coin of the realm of stable partnerships. So with that backdrop, our strengthening position at home, translating to strength and influence abroad, let me turn to Middle East and our U.S. policy here. President Biden's Middle East policy is clear, principled, realistic, and pragmatic, yet ambitious about what U.S. engagement and partners can achieve together. This policy, it's a new framework for the region. It was set forth clearly by the president at the GCC Plus 3 summit in Jeddah on July 16th, later incorporated formally into our national security strategy that was released just 2 months later. It's based on America's unparalleled comparative advantage in building partnerships to strengthen deterrence while using diplomacy where possible, to de-escalate tensions, reduce risks of new conflicts, set a long-term foundation for stability with a sustainable and permanent U.S. force posture. The framework has 5 declaratory principles. It's effectively a Biden doctrine, and it's worth laying out just in some brief detail. So let me just run through it. The first principle is partnerships. The title of this panel. The United States will support and strengthen partnerships with countries that subscribe to the rules-based international order, and we will make sure that those countries can defend themselves against foreign threats. And as the president said in Jeddah, the countries around that table are very much a part of that order. The second principle is deterrence. The United States will not allow foreign or regional powers to jeopardize freedom of navigation through the Middle East waterways, including the Strait of Hormuz, Bab el-Mandeb, the topic of the previous panel, nor tolerate efforts by any country to dominate another or the region through military buildups, incursions, or threats. The third principle is diplomacy. The United States will not just aim to deter threats to regional stability, we will work to reduce tensions, de-escalate, and end conflicts wherever possible through diplomacy. Fourth principle, integration. The United States will build political, economic, and security connections between U.S. partners whenever possible, while respecting each country's sovereignty and independent choices. And finally, the fifth principle of values. The United States will always promote human rights and values enshrined in the UN Charter. These principles, partnerships, deterrence, diplomacy, integration, and values, are not slogans. They are truly mutually reinforcing elements of national policy that is delivering results, even in the face of significant global risk and uncertainty. Let me just provide some examples of what we've done just over the last year. Partnerships. If you go back almost 2 years from the beginning of our administration, we've worked to strengthen relations with longstanding partners in the region, from Morocco to Egypt, Israel, here in the GCC, through 200 military exercises, strategic dialogues, high-level visits, including now two presidential visits, exchanges, and constant engagement, albeit often behind the scenes, counterpart to counterpart. We're building new partnerships, as you all just laid out, in formats such as I2U2 or the Negev Forum, to tackle pressing challenges from food security to climate change. Deterrence. In the last 2 years, the United States has acted militarily against threats from Iran and its proxies. We've enhanced the deterrence capacity of our partners. We've established new and innovative, the focus of General Kirilla's speech, which if you didn't see it, I really would recommend reading it in detail, innovative maritime domain awareness networks, and at times through close cooperation, we have exposed and deterred imminent threats, such as what happened here just 3 weeks ago when Iran was preparing for an attack against Saudi Arabia. That attack likely did not occur because of the close security cooperation between Saudi Arabia and the United States, which is ongoing and continuous. And the United States is very much maintaining our forward military presence here in the region, as you heard from Colin. Diplomacy. U.S. diplomacy, over the last year, we focused on healing the unnecessary Gulf Rift. The GCC, we think, is more united now than it has been in years. We've encouraged the important rapprochement between rival capitals in this region. We've helped enable the most sustained de-escalation in Yemen, now going on 8 months since the war began, recognizing there's much more work to do there. Established, as has been mentioned by both my panel colleagues, established for the first time in history an agreed maritime boundary between Israel and Lebanon. We have reunited the United States and Europe and much of the world against Iran. This is not the case when we entered office. With respect to its nuclear activities, treatment of its own people, proliferation of weapons from Yemen to Ukraine, and I assure you here there is more to come on the diplomatic front, including some work we just got done here yesterday, thanks to this forum bringing so many different people together. But more to follow on that, and we could talk about it hopefully next year at this time. Integration. The United States is now actively building and enabling an integrated air and maritime defense architecture in this region. Something long talked about is now being done through innovative partnerships and new technologies. And beyond security, we are supporting infrastructure connections through Iraq, the Gulf, and Jordan, supporting new free trade agreements between Israel, UAE, and Bahrain, opening airspace, including, as you all just mentioned, for Israeli civilian aircraft flying over Saudi Arabia, all the essential elements for an interconnected, prosperous, stable region over time. Finally, values. Just as we are always striving to perfect our own imperfect democracy, we will always raise concerns regarding basic rights and our engagements here and elsewhere. The President did so in his visit here in July and in Egypt just 2 weeks ago. It's who he is, and it's who we are as Americans. The United States remains the world's largest bilateral donor of humanitarian assistance in this region, and we urge our partners to act in words and deeds in line with the essential principles of the UN Charter, which is why it's important that nearly every U.S. partner in this region has now voted in the UN General Assembly to condemn Iran's invasion and illegal annexation of portions of Ukraine. So in closing, just return to the theme of this panel, partnerships. It's the first principle for U.S. policy in the region, both strengthening those that exist, developing new ones, and through these partnerships, building new coalitions and alliances to address specific challenges from Iran to food and energy security to the energy transition, pandemics, and climate change. As you heard from others on this stage over the course of the weekend, this is a unique comparative advantage of ours, the United States, building coalitions and alliances, integrating defense structures, using diplomacy to bring people together and try to de-escalate conflicts where possible. And it's one we'll work to enhance over the coming months and years as we increase our own resilience and strength at home and abroad, particularly here in this vital region where we unquestionably are here to stay. And very much look forward to the questions and discussion. Thank you.
Brett, thank you very much. With well, you and your two colleagues have inspired something like 36 calls for the floor. I'll try to take about eight or nine before coming back to the panel. Could I start with the UK, Nigel Gould-Davis?
Thank you. A question for Dr. Hulata. You noted the globally destabilizing activities of Iran and drew attention in particular to the use of Iranian drones in Ukraine, in the context, of course, of a war of aggression that undermines international norms and has been waged on the fictitious pretext of denazification. There are some in Europe and the United States, and I believe in Israel too, who take the view that Israel might do more to provide practical, beyond diplomatic support for Ukraine, including but not only the provision of air defenses. And I was wondering what you thought on this matter. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, His Royal Highness Prince Turki.
I'm going to talk about that now. Thank you, John. Question to Mr. Hulata. Seeing as how much you gained from the so-called Abrahamic Accords and flying over Saudi Arabian airspace and so on, would you give the same consideration to the innocent Palestinian women and children who are being oppressed under your occupation as you give to the Iranian women and children under oppression from the Iranian regime?
Could I bring in Reem Momtaz now, please?
Thank you, John. I have a question for Brett McGurk. I was struck when you said that you've reunited much of the world against Iran. I was looking at the way this part of the world, the GCC countries, voted yesterday at the UN General Assembly on the resolution condemning Iran on human rights. And I'm struck that only two of the countries voted in favor of that resolution. I wonder how you read that in light of your statement. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think the vote was Saudi Arabia and Bahrain in favor, and Kuwait and the UAE and Qatar abstaining, and Oman against. So it was a bit of GCC diversity in that particular instance. Could I ask Vira Solanki, please?
Thank you, John. I have a two-part question on the I2U2 group, which both Dr. Hulata and Brett McGurk mentioned. Firstly, you highlighted the economic aspect of this grouping. Going forward, do you see an opportunity for the grouping to have a security focus, in particular on maritime security, now that Israel has participated for the first time in the US-led international maritime exercise alongside the UAE and India, and also on counterterrorism, with all four members of this grouping having a similar perspective on this issue? And secondly, do you see any challenge on the fact that the group doesn't have a similar perspective in terms of China? Both the US and India view China as their most important strategic challenge, and Israel and the UAE see China as an important partner. So how does this raise questions on the sustainability of the ITU2 group? Thank you.
And from the UAE, Marwan al-Blushi.
Thank you, John. So my question is to Dr. Hulata. I'm wondering if you can chart out to us the Israeli rules of the game in the Middle East with a nuclear-armed Iran. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mohammed Saladin Hassan from Egypt.
Thank you, John. My question to Mr. Dindias, the foreign minister of Greece. Of course, in your presentation, sir, you have described the situation in the East Mediterranean as all wine and roses. In fact, the shortfalls coming from the impact of those imaginary maps that been published about exclusive economic zone and agreements with some countries, which is not based on international law or the international law of seas. What's your, comment on that? Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. And from Israel, Tommy Steiner.
Thank you, John. A question, first of all, to Mr. McGurk. I listened carefully to your remarks, and there is an elephant in the room which you did not mention, which essentially is China. Now, there is reason to believe that if you would state clearly that because of China, US is far more committed to the Middle East than ever before, which, you know, a decade ago there was an opposite concern. Today it's different. So the question is, why not mention it straight on? Because that allows Israel to assume that ITU2 has nothing to do with China and that the high-tech dialogue has nothing to do, like the G5 or G6 initiative with Saudi Arabia, nothing to do with China. I can go on and on.
So. Thank you very much. Irene Mia from Italy and the IISS.
Thanks, John. I was wondering whether the panelists can expand on the state of cooperation on key issues of soft security, including migration and food security and climate vulnerability and adaptation in the broader region. Thank you.
And from Bahrain, Hassan Al-Hassan.
Thank you very much, John. My question is addressed to Mr. McGurk. Mr. McGurk, you mentioned and referenced the PGII, the Partnership on Global Infrastructure and Investment. It seems to me that the US has been actually geo-economically absent from the MENA region. In terms of trade, it's overtaken by China. Its free trade agreements that the US has signed is with the smallest economies in the region, Bahrain, Jordan, Oman, and Morocco. In terms of aid, most of the aid that the US has disbursed, around $350 billion since 1946, has been in the form of military assistance to Israel and to a lesser extent, Jordan and Egypt. In the follow-up to the Jeddah summit, most of the geoeconomic announcements were all about GCC-funded initiatives, with only a $1 billion announcement that I have seen on the part of the US to help promote food security in the region. Is the US well-equipped geoeconomically to compete with China in the MENA region? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And from the US, Lawrence Rubin.
Yes, thank you very much. My question is for all the panelists. What do you fear could be the biggest kind of event, domestic or international, to break up this momentum that all of the panelists are talking about in terms of the enthusiasm, well, partly enthusiasm, of course, cautious, that that they see?
And from India, Asif Shuja.
Thank you so much. My question is for our panelists from Israel. You have mentioned, and we all know, that President Biden has said that Iran will never be allowed to have a nuclear weapon. Now, we can safely assume that he must also be having a plan to counter that. In your view, which is more secretive in nature, the Iranian nuclear program or the plan to counter it? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'll take two more questions before coming back to the panel. And tactical warning is that I will ask them to respond in the order in which they originally spoke. So two more questions, though. Ebtissem Al-Ketbi from the UAE.
Thank you, John. I have two questions. First to Mr. Bert McGurk, that many here mentioned China, but when we met, I remember in DC, and I asked you about the US commitment to GCC, you assured me that you are still committed. And you mentioned in your speech all the aspects. But my worry, because what I heard from Undersecretary of Defense, Colin Kahl, that either us or you, so this commitment will be conditioned by our relation with China, which we look to China, we don't look at China as a threat like yours. And they are a strategic partnership in terms of economy. My second question to Mr. Olata, what about when you mentioned, I do believe in Abraham Accord, but my worry, Netanyahu is coming to power now, and his bad relation with King of Jordan, which it was in the past, that it will affect this cooperation. The other things, my worry, these extremists, which are coming, which I call them the Jewish Salafists, which will endanger this in terms of the two-state solution, which it was in the previous government, there is a way, but they are, it seems, blocking that there is no state solution, which I think you believe in. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm looking for the next person that I had on my list who has disappeared from my list in the interim, but I'll get Aaron Connolly to come in, please.
Thanks, John. Dr. Hulata, I wanted to ask you, in light of the discussion of the Abraham Accords on this panel, where the Israel-Indonesia relationship goes from here. There's a quite robust unofficial relationship with Indonesia, but despite efforts to get Indonesia to join the Abraham Accords, they've chosen not to do that. I wonder where you see that relationship going from here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, Nicholas Dendias, any comment on what you've heard from the floor and a couple of additions? Yeah.
My agenda is rather limited on the question asked me, to me, so that's which quite good, means not many, or at least not that many problems in my plate. Well, I first of all, on the question asked by the Egyptian general, what I try to do is strike an optimist note in a very dark situation for the world. That's why I picked two successes. If I look at our failures or to the crises we're watching around, then the catalogue will be endless and I will be talking from morning to evening and start the next morning. Now, for our region, for example, I could name three. A, Syria. Syria is a failed state. And let me be honest, we don't have a policy to address the situation in Syria. And by we mean the Western world, the value-oriented society. We're just bywatchers. We do nothing. Libya. In Libya, we have something like two governments, five factions, numerous militias. You name it, it's there. And Libya is asking us a disruptor in two ways. It signs illegal agreements with Turkey, creating potential problems, and with just saying problems, I understate what may happen with Greece. And at the same time, spreads weapons to the Sahel. And in the Sahel, we see a situation which goes beyond control. And we have a very few thousand French, with the help of the United States and small help from a few others, who try to control an area which is two times the size of the United States. And of course, I was in the Niger just a few days ago, and please let me tell you, we are failing in the Sahel. And last but not least, Turkey. Turkey acts as a disruptor. Turkey does not accept international law, does not accept international law of the sea, is a NATO member country, does not impose any sanction of Russia. If you look at the Turkish budget this year, you will see 30 added billions. This is the profits of Turkey because of the Russian invasion in Ukraine and Turkey not imposing any sanctions on Russia and 800 Russian companies relocating to Turkey. So there are many, many problems. But what I tried to show is that problems are resolvable. It is not something that we cannot address. If we have rules, if we have a rules-based order, and if we have goodwill, all the problems we are facing today, or at least most of them, are addressable. And we should not resign from the hope that we can create a better world. We should not allow despair to cover our region. And on the second question asked to me, what I'm afraid of, I'll tell you clearly, is A, lose of hope, I said it before, stop trying, resign from creating a better world, and B, allow the revisionist narrative to prevail, to become overdominant. That is why I hope that Ukraine will be successful. Because it is not just a victory for Ukraine as a country against an aggressor. Greece has nothing against Russia. It is defeat of the revisionist narrative. If the Russian invasion of Ukraine was successful, what do you think would stop President Erdogan imitating it? Or what would stop other authoritarian rulers imitating the example? So, I will again finish with a positive remark. We can create a better humanity. We have all the resources to address the challenges, including, by the way, climate change, which affects this region. But we have to believe in it and try hard. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Ella Hulata.
Thank you. Yeah, so quite a few questions for me. I will address them, and some of these conversations we can continue later if you want. First on Ukraine, the Israeli policy with regard to Ukraine, I think was clear. We've condemned the invasion and the brutality against civilians. We've extended a lot of humanitarian aid, much more than that was put out in press, and welcomed refugees in large amounts. We've been active, me personally, the Prime Minister and others, before the war started to try to prevent it and to facilitate an end to it, knowing that the longer it extends, the worse it will be for everybody. We're also collaborating with the Ukrainians on various issues, which I will keep it at that. I will say that the Iranian support in arms and in money evasion mechanisms to the Russians worries us very much. And in this process, we're coordinating our responses with the Americans and with the Europeans. And I would assume that this process will continue with the new government as well to address those issues more directly. As for the question on the Palestinians, first, I think that it is fair to say that during this last year, this government has done a lot to improve the well-being of the population in the West Bank. More workers in Israel, both from the West Bank and from Gaza. We've addressed freedom of travel, checkpoints, border crossing, and this is despite the fact that there was no conditions for a political progress or process. The issue for us has always been and is security. When there are terror activities in our cities, we react. I think over the last year, we have reacted more surgically than before, with more collaboration with the PA security forces, and the results were short and more concise and less collateral damage and casualties around. I think, personal belief, and I think this is the belief of every Israeli from all the political aspects, that the Abraham Accords have a positive impact on this process, and a positive impact on the well-being also of the Palestinians. And the prospect of that is that as violence is reduced and calmed, potentially processes will be able to emerge in the future. Brett, the ITU two questions I will divert to you. I will also just respond to the question about Iran. So, I mean, the question about what will the U.S. do, I'm sure Brett will respond. I will say that it is Israel's commitment to ensure that Iran does not go nuclear. We've said this for years and years. If it comes to that, we will do whatever it takes to prevent Iran from going nuclear. We feel that this is also the commitment of President Biden. We build upon this partnership for the future. I will say that we treat that as a contingency that we must prepare to, but we strongly believe that if the international community works together, and I think there are new conditions for that at this point, it doesn't have to get to war. But if it so happens, Israel will be prepared. Thank you.
Brett McGurk.
Thanks. I'll go in order here. On Iran, I think there was a question about, is the world really united? Look, I think you heard the speakers here, including the opening speaker with Ursula von der Leyen talking about the EU policy. This is a real, I think, a sea change in terms of how the world is looking at Iran. We are very much coordinating sanctions policy from the U.S., EU sanctions, U.K. sanctions. You see them on drones, on human rights and everything else, a very coordinated global effort. So I think UN General Assembly votes can be a little strange sometimes. It depends on how certain things are phrased. But I think generally speaking, if you look at even what's coming this week with an unprecedented meeting in Geneva in the Human Rights Council on Iran. I think we really have done a good job at uniting a lot of key players. The Iranian protests, drones, nuclear file, terrorism, everything else. A couple questions on China, and I think Colin's remarks. I think Colin very much laid out what is a truism, that recognize the economic relationships with China. We have the largest trading partnership with China. That's something that is not a surprise. Xi Jinping was here in the region in 2016. He would have been here if not for COVID earlier. He'll be here, I think, next month. That's not a particular surprise. When it comes to the unique comparative advantage of the United States of America, which we talked about, the American officials on this stage over the course of these 3 days, our integrated defense structures, our integrated defense architecture, what we can uniquely do militarily to create a security architecture in this region, that is a demand we hear from capital to capital that we are very committed to building. There are certain partnerships with China that would create a ceiling on what we can do. It's simply a fact, and that is something that would, that's the truth here, it's the truth anywhere else in the world, based upon relationships between countries that are military competitors of ours. So that is just a truism that I think Colin spoke to just very factually. But thus far, we are not seeing that type of relationship that is getting in the way of what we are working here to build. And I2U2, I think it is a very good example of using diplomacy to think about how to pull together countries who have mutual interests on specific issues and harness expertise, resources. The specific deliverable in the head of state I2U2, the first head of state I2U2, was a very ambitious food security initiative focused particularly on India, and I think we can build from there. Oftentimes in these, Abraham Accords is a good example. The security discussion, security cooperation, much of it is below the surface, and then ultimately rises to the surface. So I won't get ahead of that process in terms of where I2U2 might be going, but we think it is a format and a quartet that really can have some semblance and really some possibility here as we look ahead. PGII is a historic initiative that was launched at the G7 summit earlier this year. There was a session on it at the G20 just last week. And it was a focus of the president's visit here in the GCC+3 summit. I think it's a misnomer to look at U.S. government investment because we are harnessing our private sector investment. If you look at the historic bilateral agreement we reached with UAE about 3 weeks ago called PACE, the Agreement on Clean Energy, where we are mobilizing $100 billion mostly in private capital for unique investments in the clean energy future. That is something, again, the United States can uniquely do. And after we signed those agreements with Sheikh Mohammed in UAE, we flew back, saw the president, had a video conference between Sheikh Mohammed and President Biden, and then a number of senior officials met with the largest banks and private equity firms in New York City to talk about PGII, PACE, other things that we are working on. So that is, again, something, a unique capacity of the United States. I wouldn't just look at U.S. government dollars, although we are investing enormously now, U.S. government dollars in our own country, which I think is so important. I think that addressed most of the round, so I think we can go.
Brett, thank you very much. We'll take six or seven more, and then when I come back to the panel, we'll come back in reverse order and seeing at the end what the balance is between pessimism and optimism from the Greek foreign minister. Let's start with Saudi Arabia and Shafi Aldana.
Thank you so much, John, for coming back to us. My question is to the Greek minister, Nicola, about, we'd like to hear your view on the ongoing Ukraine war and relation between Greece and the Gulf states and Europe in general, and also on the role that is being played now by Saudi Arabia, especially in trying to find a peaceful end for the ongoing crisis war in Ukraine. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And from the UK, John Rain.
Thank you, John. Looking at the new partnerships, it seems to prove the fact that countries can choose their partners, but they can't choose their neighbors. And one neighbor which is material to the stability of a number of key Middle East countries, Syria, Iraq, and Iran, is Turkey. And I can't quite see yet where Turkey fits in to the new lattice work of partnerships in the Middle East. And do the panel think that the new partnerships can solve the old problems without Turkey being in there somewhere?
Thank you very much. And Noah Bonsley from the US.
Thanks. A question to Mr. McGurk on the nexus of conflict between northern Syria, northern Iraq, and Turkey as well. Of course, there was a bombing in Istanbul last week. There were airstrikes by Turkey in northern Iraq and Syria last night. There have also been some solid reasons to believe that while de-escalation is clearly necessary, that there is some room for U.S. diplomacy. The specific question would be, it at times is seen that U.S. diplomacy on this complex transborder issue set has been hampered by a sort of Sykes-Picot within U.S. bureaucracy, right, between EUCOM and CENTCOM, between Europe and MENA, or Europe and NEA and NSC and state. Is there any prospect of a U.S. approach to sort of overcome those institutional divides and empower U.S. diplomacy, maybe through appointment of a or empowerment of a senior official who could transcend that line? Thanks.
Thank you very much. And from Turkey, Esin Çatıyol.
Thank you very much. This is not a question, but a clarification of what the minister, Dendias, mentioned recently. Our foreign policy is shaped upon the principle of peace, international law, and diplomacy. And for the Russian-Ukrainian conflict, from the very beginning, Turkey supported the territorial integrity and sovereignty of Ukraine within its internationally recognized borders and extended comprehensive humanitarian and political support. And at the same time, we hosted the Ukraine-Russia talks as a facilitator in Antalya and Istanbul. And unfortunately, what you said, Mr. Minister, about the President Erdogan is absolutely unacceptable. Thank you very much.
From the UK, Tom Beckett.
Thank you, John. I've heard a concern that Iran may, alongside the drones that it's been transferring to Russia, may begin to transfer ballistic missiles, noting that interdiction efforts to prevent Iran sending them to the Houthi have not been wholly successful. What confidence would we have that they could be interdicted going to Russia? And could any new measures be applied to Iran's proliferation of weapons in the region?
And from Italy, Maria Fantapi.
Thank you, John. A question for Mr. Hulata. You have spoken about regional integration. However, what regional integration, the way you have presented, very much look like as a also security alliance against Iran. How can you ensure that this security alliance against Iran doesn't actually unleash an escalation that will eventually backfire on your very partners here in the Gulf? Thank you very much. And also, second question for Mr. Dendias. What is possible in terms of European Union approach to de-escalatory measures in this region, also when it comes to keeping the door open for a dialogue with Iran, because this door seems to be closing. Thank you.
And Hafsa Halawa from the UK.
Thank you very much. One question to the entire panel vis-a-vis Iran. There appears to be credible threats being made of an invasion into northern Iraq to counter what is happening domestically. To what extent are these new security partnerships able to respond to that, and what would that look like? And a second quick question to Mr. McGurk. You mentioned clear, principled, pragmatic, and values-based agenda for foreign policy and security relationships. How does the U.S. administration reconcile that with its friendship and partnership with Israel and the continued behavior towards the Palestinians and the refusal of the right to self-determination? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And from China, Tingyi Wang.
Hello. This question actually for all participants, especially for our American colleague. My question is still Palestinian issue the key issue of Middle East affairs? For these states who have historical responsibility for this, do you have any concern of human rights there? Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I think we'll come back to the panel. I apologize to the 14 to 16 people who I wasn't able to bring in. I tried to bring in people who hadn't yet had a chance to take the floor. So thank you very much for your understanding. We'll go, as I advertised, in reverse order of the way in which they originally spoke. So Brett McGurk first, please, a couple minutes each.
Thanks. Real quick, I think Turkey's role in this architecture, the polarization we saw a couple years ago, I think we do support the rapprochement between whether it's Ankara, Abu Dhabi, Ankara, Riyadh, Ankara, Cairo. We think that's good. Dialogue is good, even when there are still differences there. And so that's something we have very much encouraged. That gets to the question in northern Syria. A very complicated situation, fairly well familiar with it from former roles I've had. We inherited a situation that might not have been how we drew it up, but we maintain a military presence in the eastern portion of Syria. We will continue to maintain that military presence. We believe it is essential to ensure ISIS cannot resurge. There is a camp at Al-Hol with about 50,000 people that is an international problem. We need to put international attention on it, and our military presence there is quite important, and it will remain. We have seen the attack in Istanbul, obviously, last week. We condemn that attack. We condemn all acts of terrorism. We have extended our sympathies to the victims. President Biden met with President Erdogan at the G20. We do not have information on who carried out that attack. Turkey has information they say they have. That's fine. We're happy to share information with Turkey on all of these threats. And of course, we saw the airstrikes last night. That's breaking news. All I can say is we want to make sure that nothing is done to further destabilize that very difficult situation in northeast Syria. We think we want to try to maintain stability there, and obviously we do want to make sure that the border with Turkey is secure. On Iran and UAVs, it's not just interdictions, it is sanctions and a number of other measures that we are taking, and kind of week to week you can see this play out to try to get after that problem. It's not the UAV trade to Russia for use in Ukraine. That is one piece of the puzzle, but what's happening now is really a military consortium between Iran and Russia that threatens to significantly increase the capacities and capabilities of Iran, which is even more of a threat here to the region. There's a question on Israel and tension with our values. I reject the premise. I think fundamentally, as President Biden has said, if Israel did not exist, we would have to invent it. We also are very focused on the situation with the Palestinians in the West Bank. President Biden traveled to Bethlehem, met with the Palestinian leadership. We are doing all we possibly can, and we have said if the parties are ready to have a dialogue, we are ready as well. But we are very focused on that problem. We have a three-star general in Israel focused on security cooperation, trying to diffuse tensions wherever we can. I think that covers it, John.
Dr. El-Hulata.
Thank you. So first on the regional collaboration question, I think we gave a lot of emphasis this year for the collaboration to be on things that are not just security. Economy, people to people, private sector to private sector, so that this does not reside only in the context as you asked of just security arrangements. And I think this is crucially important for this to last for long and to add more countries into it. The defense collaboration and the security architectures as they are being evolved, their intention is to allow for better defense for the various issues. Israel does not expect any of the countries not to fight on our behalf or to suffer because of our unique security considerations. When these countries are being attacked, it is not because of us, it is because they're being attacked by Iran. And if we can assist them in being defended, then this is, I think, our obligation and duty. And in light of the other questions, and given the fact that the World Cup is starting today, I want to give you an assist on optimism for you to score. And I mean, this the Middle East is a difficult neighborhood any day of the week. And I think that if we look at it from an historic perspective and look at how the blocs and coalitions have evolved over the dozens of years, many things have shifted, and most of them, I think, generally, are for the good. I think what we need to do is to continue to make sure that we're working towards the right direction, and with hope and hard work to do our part and share to leave behind us a better place. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Foreign Minister.
Yes, well, I'll try to keep it as short as possible. First of all, the issue that has to do with Ukraine and with the Saudi Kingdom. Well, we Greece see ourselves as an entry point towards the Balkans, towards Central Europe, and towards supporting the Ukrainian effort. We have a port in northeastern Greece, Alexandroupolis, which is the main port now used by NATO to support Ukraine. But also, we see ourselves as energy hubs. We can transfer energy from the Arab world, from Africa towards Europe. And there's a lot of infrastructure, of pipelines, of interconnectors that are being developed as we speak to address the challenge that Europe faces on energy, especially the Balkans and Central and Eastern Europe. And on the other hand, on the cultural level, on the level of identity, I think we are well qualified because of our geographical position and of our history to understand the Arab world better and become the interlocutors between the Arab world and the European Union. We are at a cultural cross point, and we could be extremely useful on that. And I have to say, we're watching with great interest the reform of the Saudi Kingdom, the reform effort. On the issue of where Turkey fits within the architecture of the region, well, for us, this is clear. Eventually, Turkey will have to fit in the security architecture of Eastern Mediterranean. Turkey is a big country with a very big population, with a very important economy, and we cannot ignore its presence. What we hope is that Turkey's policies serve this goal of ours. Please allow me to say that Greece is the only country, I repeat, the only country that still clearly favors Turkey's candidacy to the European Union, of course, upon the conditionality. Human rights, rights of women, et cetera, institution building, et cetera, but in principle, we would like Turkey in, not out. The question is, does Turkey's policies serve this goal or not? And let me give you two examples. Casus belli. Turkey is the only country in the world, I repeat, the only country in the world that have issued a threat of war against another country, Greece, if Greece exercises its lawful rights according to international law of the sea and extends territorial waters in the Aegean to 12 miles. How could that happen in the 21st century? B, delimits sea zones with the so-called government of Libya against international law, ignoring that islands have all rights as the mainland. To give you an example, is as if Greece would delimiting the central Mediterranean with Tunisia, ignoring the presence of Italy. So the lines go over Sicily as the lines there go over Crete. So Turkey has to understand that it has to function within the rules-based order. And then, of course, Turkey will become an integral part of the security arrangement of this region. On Iran and the European Union. Iran, as we all know here, regardless of from which angle we see this, is a very difficult case. You know that the European Union, I'm not speaking for Greece, I'm speaking for the European Union. The European Union was very positive for the JCPOA, and it tried again to reignite the discussions on the JCPOA, as did the government of the United States. And huge effort was there, but unfortunately, up to now, it didn't work out. And I have to say, now, as the Greek foreign minister, that Iran plays many times as the disruptor. That is what it is. Not just on the JCPOA, not just on the nuclear weapons, on many fronts. So, again, we need a clear policy towards Iran that can show to Iran that Iran has much to gain by becoming a normal actor in the international affairs.
Thank you very much. Well, two announcements. First of all, you have now a 28-minute coffee break. Please return to the hall at 12 o'clock for our concluding session with four brilliant IISS analysts. And could you please show your appreciation for what was a really fantastic panel? Thank you very much indeed.